It's 8:30 at night. You take a shower because you won't have time in the morning. Your kids go to sleep in their clothes so they don't have to get dressed in the morning. You find out who's buying lunch and who needs a lunch packed, and eventually you go to sleep. This is what happens in some of the homes of Unitarian Universalists. I asked a handful of parents to describe to me a day in their life, and this is a composite. However, one shared, the below is the schedule for an ordinary day with no significant hitches, no bouts of anxiety before school resulting in avoiding challenges, i.e., I don't want to run the mile today, or I'm not ready for this test, I just can't go. No forgotten school books, assignments, no calls from school that someone is sick, no repairmen or other service providers needing access to the house during the day, no appointments for kids, animals, we have three, or myself, no lunch meetings or seminars or out-of-town travel, no car appointments, and so on. Just a normal day, which I might add aren't all that normal because they don't happen that often, but I sure love it when I get one. It's 5:20, it's time to wake up. It's 6:30, you and your kids make your lunches and breakfast, and you take whatever's listed for dinner out of the freezer and you let it thaw in the fridge while your partner takes the dog out. Your kids get ready for school, and at 7:30, you leave for work. And then you work all day. And if you're lucky, you get to be home at 3 o'clock when your kids come home. You get to supervise them with guitar practice, having a snack, driving them to Boy or Girl Scouts. At 4 p.m., they might go outside to play with some kids in the neighborhood or go to one of their activities. At 6, if you're lucky, one of your kids helps you make dinner. Your spouse arrives, and you all sit down together briefly for a meal, giving you a chance to connect. When it's over, someone cleans up. Someone else walks the dog. You send the kids to the shower if needed. Homework gets done at 8:30. While the girls read, you take your shower. You have the chance to relax together in bed, talking about the day before you sleep. And you take your rest to do it all again. Does that sound familiar to anyone? Anything kind of like that? Well, I wonder if maybe that's why people like worship. Because you have a whole hour you just sit still. And it might just be for part of the hour that you find yourself really settling in. And it might be different parts of the service that grab you each week. But regardless, the blur of life whizzing past you slows down where you can actually see something with a little more clarity. Things like, huh, I have a body. And it's kind of achy when we sit here in meditation. Or, I have a heart. There's more to me than the roles I work so hard to fulfill every day. This happened to me last Sunday during the meditation. Mark invited us into a time to open to life in the common breath, allowing grace to renew us. And hearing this invitation, and I don't know if you were here at the early service, there were just babies making sounds. It was beautiful and so joyful. And I thought, I'm grumpy. There's so much to be happy about. And I'm glad I'm not preaching today because I don't know what it is. I couldn't find my way into the peace that Mark had on his face as he held the space for everyone. And so I had these moments to actually ask myself, I wonder what that's about. And immediately tears just started streaming down my face. There was a sadness on my heart that I hadn't made room for, that hadn't caught up with me yet. I knew that the day before I was in a really bad mood, and I was trying not to be snarky with my husband, but it was a sunny day, and I just felt like everything stinks. And during the pause in church, my heart was like, hey, this is what's going on. It's good to pause and let our lives catch up with us. Our feelings, our intuitions, the mere fact of our existence. And when we can't connect with that gift, to ask why. And this isn't something that can only happen on a Sunday. Erin, I'm preaching about this for a reason this week. I realize this is really the message I need to hear, and I hope that it's useful to you as well. But we can pause any time in the week, at the traffic light, before the staff meeting, before we eat our meal, when we're watching our puppy mosey around in the backyard. We can pause and let our lives catch up with us, This is basically what a spiritual practice invites us to do, to pause, open up, consider. A fundamental spiritual practice in many religions and many times in my own life is prayer. And I'm preaching about it this week because it's fallen off of my schedule. It's something I have forgotten about. A spiritual director of mine used to say that we pray each day, or when we can remember to pray each day, in order to make a deposit into our spiritual savings account. And there are times when life gets rough and you need to make a major withdrawal. But you can't put nothing in and then expect to get precious commodities out like perspective and peace when you're spiritually bankrupt. So she would encourage me to just pause every day and say some kind of prayer to help me make that deposit for myself. And for me, at times, this looks like every time I get in the car, I just leave the radio off as a reminder to do that kind of, pause. Think about the larger life rather than just the next thing in front of me. And often what I say in my car, I'll just say over and over again a slightly different version of this serenity prayer. Just God grant me this serenity to accept the people I cannot change, the courage to change the person I can, and the wisdom to know it's me. Sounds funny, but it's so true in my life. And I'll just say this over and over again to help me get perspective on what's really mine today, to let go of the things that aren't, and to bring forth the love that I can. And you may call this, you may say, well, that's not really prayer, Erin. That's mindfulness or that's meditation. And you may have a hard time with the word prayer. You may reject it. And you may think that prayer is a petition, that it's asking a higher power to do something for you. You may think of prayer as worshiping something. Or like me, maybe you've grown up, that prayer is your duty. It's something God needs from you. A friend of mine from seminary said that she, as a child, was taught that if she didn't pray good enough or hard enough, and someone in her family fell ill, that it was because of her bad behavior or her lack of devotion that someone was sick. So some people have been greatly hurt by some people's understandings of the function of prayer. And so if you reject the term and you wonder, why is she talking about this? Well, then I'm really glad you're here. Maybe you didn't know. But that's what I'd be talking about today. I know prayer has caused pain in people's lives, but I also know that prayer has helped heal people's lives. And when I speak of healing, I don't mean healing of the body or of the world around us. I mean of our own spirits and hearts. And the journey towards this definition of prayer has taken me quite some time. I was raised Catholic, and I was really taught that the only times we pray is during penance, actually. After you've confessed your sins, you would go into the sanctuary, and you would say, you would get a prescription for how many Hail Marys and how many Our Fathers to say. And so I, as a kid, actually, would stand in line before confession and make up my sins to go report to the priest. And I was doing it very genuinely, but I have no idea how many times I had sinned. And since I had been told how many times to pray, I thought I should tell how many times I had sinned. I think it would be awesome to be a priest hearing my confessions, children's confessions. But other than that, the really only time I was encouraged to pray was when we did it aloud with prescripted prayers in language that I often didn't really understand. As an adult, I started accidentally running across people and stories that inspired me to expand my definition of prayer. And one of them was the author Anne Lamott. She wrote in Traveling Mercies that there are likely two prayers that you will only ever need in your life. And one is help, and the other is thank you. And a friend of hers says that she does basically the same thing, but every morning she says, whatever. And at the end of the day, she says, oh, well. For a long time, I had a mobile hanging in my bedroom that a friend of mine made. That one side, it was beautifully painted with watercolors. One side was orange, one side was purple, and one side said, whatever. And the other said, oh, well. And that was my experience of prayer, just a visual reminder to, I open myself to what the day will bring and the ways in which I can be of use, whatever. I accept life on life's terms and myself as I am. I'm grateful for today being exactly what it was. Oh well. Help and thank you, whatever, and oh well, that was what prayer meant for me in the beginning. But later in my life, when I hit a painful wall and I kept hitting it and hitting it and hitting it by resenting someone in my family, you know, those people you tend to run into a lot in your life. Well, I kept hitting myself in the head, in my heart, with my own resentment and decided that I didn't want to hurt like that anymore. And someone taught me the prayer practice that I offered during the meditation today, which is to pray for the people who bother you. And over time, as I did that, many months, it started to heal me. The painful impasses in my heart transformed, and I found a way not to entirely love that person or be in love with who that person was, but to release the hurt. Release the person who had hurt me and genuinely wish healing for that person. I've heard the spiritual life defined as the ordinary life lived extraordinarily well. And that works for me. That's what I'm doing. And the goal that with that goal, I use prayer to achieve it. I pray not to change the world around me, but to reorient myself to it. I focus on the serenity, the acceptance, the courage, the wisdom, rather than whatever challenge is outside of me or before me. I pray so that I can pause long enough to see the world more clearly, to step outside of how my fear is seeing things, or my anger, or my shame, or my pride, you name it. I pray so that I can once again choose what is going to drive this ship. And what's amazing is that as I've learned to open to prayer and allow myself to try out these practices, I've found a language of reverence that holds my own experience, my own humanity, in a way that I respond to myself with warmth. My trials are no longer spoken about with just like, he did this and she did that, and I'm so, instead, because actually that's how I sound in my head sometimes. But instead of speaking about my life and the things that I encounter, which are just like in everyone's lives, I started speaking about it with some respect and some honor. When I used to journal about my day, I would often just complain about those things that happened. That was my daily practice for a while, just journal. And then I got really bored of my complaints. And so I decided to start a gratitude list. And over time, I decided I wanted to start writing prayers. And every morning I would write a prayer. I was still speaking about my everyday life, what was amazing, what was hard, yet I was choosing to do it in a way that framed the ordinary within the extraordinary. For example, the other day I could have written that I was sad and nervous that someone I love dearly had a great disappointment and didn't get something he really wanted. And I felt heartbroken. Or I could write this prayer. Sweetness of life, thank you for my life exactly as it is. I thank you for the growth that comes with letting go. My spirit is uncomfortable as it is stretched bigger beyond my fear. I'm grateful for the courage to withstand this. I'm getting teary. It ministers to me. I can minister to myself. It's a beautiful thing. We can all do this. I'm grateful for the courage to withstand the discomfort, for the knowing within me that I can be a conduit of grace when I open to acceptance. May I ever be uncomfortable in the service of freeing up my spirit and my being to allow all of the love and grace I can to move through me and touch the lives of those I love and those I do not yet know. Amen. Yeah, I'm not moved so much when I just give a report of my life, but I am moved when I allow this language of reverence and compassion to show up and that I can hold myself and my life in this way. It helps me reframe my experience, discover a loving voice that moves from reacting to honoring. Prayer makes room for grace to live in me. And that's how prayer works in my life. Another Unitarian Universalist minister, Kate Braestrup, wrote a book. She's written several books. You may have read Here If You Need Me and Beginner's Grace. It's a book about prayer. And I've taught a class using her book called Prayer for Atheists, Agnostics, and Even Theists. And when people interview her about her work, she often starts off, people ask, like, well, tell us, Kate, does prayer work? And she'll say, no, and yes. And she says, if prayer worked, our families would never get sick. But instead, she says, prayer doesn't work. Prayer is useful. We want prayer to alter reality, and prayer won't do that. What prayer can do is open our eyes to the reality before us, to help us see what is actually happening around us, and let us see the holy in what is. And the prayers reveal that what is holy is love. If my prayers can't do that for me, they can't let me see reality and see that love is holy, then frankly, prayer wouldn't be worth doing, let alone writing about. I like to think of prayer as a spiritual tool to help us commune with the moment. Communion, not necessarily with a supernatural power, but with all that is. Again, you may say, well, that sounds like my practice of meditation or mindfulness. But I think that prayer and meditation and mindfulness, they might have similar end results where we have this ease or renewed perspective. But meditation, if you've ever studied meditation, it's like a different means to a similar end. Meditation, I think about it as if you're in a conversation trying to commune with the moment, prayer is the talking part and meditation is the listening. And so for some of us, when we're having a hard time, imagine being in a hospital room or waiting for that phone call about your sister. The thought of just sitting and breathing in meditation, drawing my attention to my breath over and over again, as the drunken monkey in my mind spews all the anxiety and fear that I have, sounds like, here, sit here and hold this burning knife. Enjoy that. It's just incredibly uncomfortable. You can feel peace. Just keep trying. It seems like a mean and cruel thing to do in a hospital room. Whereas instead, what I hope for in those moments of great anxiety in my life is that someone else can say some words that help me come to that place of mindfulness and to refocus and reframe what's going on. So imagine this with me. We're in a hospital room and someone, not a minister, just any one of you, says to the person who's really struggling, I'm gonna pray, would that be cool? Maybe you'll join me. There is love holding me. There is love holding you. There is love holding all. May I rest in that love, and may you rest in that love. It's a prayer from Rebecca Parker. There's a difference. Can you feel the difference in that? That just listening doesn't provide that invitation of naming and welcoming in that which we most need. When we invite people together to pray, we're inviting them to pay attention. Attention to how we speak, to how we listen. It's like inviting people to cross this invisible threshold together into sacred territory, where we cross out of ordinary time, out of small time, and we remember the eternal. It's throwing out a lifeline when we're facing the mess of our lives to remember what strengthens us. And in this way, prayer can be like church in your pocket. when I think of that moment that I had where my life finally caught up with me and the tears came down, I was reminded, like, Erin, you can do this any time in your week. I can say a prayer. I can have that experience of church where I allow my life to catch up with me and to hold it with reverence and beauty. And we can all do that. That's a tool you can put in your own pocket. I facilitate a group of the Soul Matters facilitators once a month, and in our meeting in September, I suggested that sometimes, when perhaps, during check-in, people might share a really difficult challenge that they're living through or some grief that they're facing. And often during check-in, we don't respond. We just actively listen and hold each other in silence with no crosstalk. And so sometimes someone has shared of a great loss or pain in their lives, and we feel awkward just sitting there like, in silence receiving. And so we said, well, what can you do? And said, well, you know, you can always ask, is there any support you would like right now from the group? Which is beautiful, to invite the person to name for themselves what that would look like. And I said, I know this might sound crazy, but you could also offer, would you like to pray together? And one person said, listen, I'm barely comfortable telling people I go to church. I'm still integrating that. I really don't think I can start praying with people. And I hear you, man. It sounds like something other people do. And I didn't get comfortable with praying with others until I was forced to in seminary when I served as a chaplain in the hospital. And I'm so grateful I had that experience to reclaim this power of speaking in beauty with one another about the hard and very real challenges of our lives. I dream of a church where we minister to each other in this way, where we feel emboldened to name and honor each other's trials and triumphs, where we do this with our children. I dream of a faith community that includes our children in our praying, that as parents, every night as they encourage their children to do their homework, to brush their teeth, to go to bed at a reasonable hour, they will also encourage the daily practices that help them find spiritual health. And that we will not just tell them this, but we will show them this. How do we live our ordinary lives extraordinarily well? That we will pause before a meal with our kids to just have gratitude. Our praying before a meal doesn't mean we are blessing it. It means we're receiving the blessing that it is. I dream of a church community where before we have our meal on a Wednesday night, a seven-year-old says, wait, hold on, I need to pray. And the child says, for the food before us, the friends beside us, and the love that surrounds us, we are truly grateful. Amen. And the people say, amen. I dream of a church where at night parents pray with their children and say, what do you give thanks for? What are you sorry for? What do you have hope for? And that they themselves then say, I give thanks for, and I am sorry for, and I have hope. I dream of a faith community where we make time to give thanks for what we have, to show our children what it really means to be satisfied. Where we create space for people of all ages to find their language of reverence, rather than just hope that they'll figure it out someday when they draw their own conclusions. No, they want a prayer now, not when they're 15 or 16 and they've had more life experience and they start defining it. They need us to be examples for them for how to have spiritual health now. I guarantee you they will make their own decisions in time. But the same way you don't say, do you want broccoli or Skittles for dinner? Please also tend to not just the nutritional health, but the spiritual health of our children, inviting them to have gratitude and thanks and hope. Because I dream of being a part of a faith community where we hold each other's ordinary lives with extraordinary beauty. Spirit of love, we pray for the courage to speak to each other's lives with holiness, beauty and love, because it takes courage, and it will feel weird, and it will be a well-hungered for moment. May we ever grow in our capacity to open our hearts and the beauty that we know within. May we ever grow in our capacity to share that with one another. Amen.